All right, welcome to Link to Liturgy. You can use this lesson this is the lesson of the woman at the well. And it's from John's chapter 4. And so I'm just going to walk through mainly the lesson on conversation to conversion, which is in the packet. It's the first lesson in the packet. And it has several points, mainly three points that I'm going to make. And just to start off, this is a conversation between two people. Remember that we believe in a God that is in three persons: Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so we have the conversation at the well. It really is a personal, it's a personal conversation between this woman and between Jesus. And we really see ourselves in this woman. So when we're looking through, the first thing that I really would recommend is just reading John chapter 4, and you would go verse 1 through 42. And when I taught this in class, into a small group, you would ask maybe everyone to break up into groups of two or three, and just to read that slowly, you know, John 4, verses 1 through 42. And really what we're really looking for, or what the groups are looking for, is to see if they can find the four main phrases or titles that this woman gives to Jesus. As the conversation progresses, her relationship with Jesus really changes. And as our life progresses, our relationship with Jesus really changes as well. So when you read this, you know, you would read it first, you know, slowly, almost like a Lectio Divina, and then you would really look for these four phrases that would jump out of what the woman is speaking to Jesus. And so just in looking at this, we'll go kind of assume that we've already read this. And at first, you know, we see that Jesus goes up to this woman in Samaria, and I think probably you would probably know that the Jews and the Samaritans are very different. The Samaritans were despised by the Jews. It would be similar to maybe like a prejudice between blacks and whites in America in the 50s and 60s during the civil rights movement and everything. Just this deep prejudice between another people and another ethnicity and whatever. And so this is what's definitely happening between the Jews and the Samaritans. Samaritans were really considered by the Jews a people that had betrayed their culture, had betrayed their homeland, and so they were despised by the Jews. And typically what would happen is a Jewish person would avoid the Samaritans altogether, because if they shared something in common, they were considered dirty. The Jew would then be unclean and would have to purify themselves. And so probably a Jew would walk right around a Samaritan neighborhood or a Samaritan you know, place where there would be Samaritan people. And Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus walks right through to the middle of town, you could say, and he goes right to the well. He encounters a Samaritan woman, who that Samaritan woman would have had no status at all. She would have been basically considered as low as a dog. And he enters this conversation with her. And so his first words, which we'll talk about a little bit later: "A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, 'Give me a drink.' His disciples had gone into town to buy food." So we know that the disciples have left. We know there's nobody else at the well except for this woman and Jesus. And it's a perfect setting for this personal conversation, which will lead to her conversion. So Jesus says, "Give me a drink." The Samaritan woman says, "How can you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink?" So we see that the first words that this woman says is she calls Jesus a Jew. And what this means is that you're different from me, all right? So she says, "You're a Jew." And what does this mean? And this would be the discussion that would probably need to go on in the group, the small group, or even the classroom, is what does it mean to be a Jew? Well, what she means is, "You're different from me." Okay? You're different from me. And she's very kind of hesitant to enter a conversation with him. "You're different than me. I don't understand you." And then we go a little bit farther, right? We go into the conversation a little bit farther, and we see that a little bit later on, she actually calls Jesus "Sir." Because, you know, why does she call him "Sir"? So this happens a little bit later. The second phrase that she says to Jesus, she says "Sir." And the reason she says this is because Jesus says, "I can give you living water. I can give you living water so that you don't have to come back to this well ever again." And back in that day, of course, they didn't have running water. They wouldn't have water in their homes like we do. And so they would have had somebody in their family, whether it be a sibling or a mom or somebody in their family, maybe a maidservant, would have had to go to the well each day, draw water, and water's pretty heavy. You know, we've carried water before in buckets, and bring that back to their house. That would have been a horrible task to do. Maybe you have to do that several times a day so that you can wash your clothes, so that you can boil your food, and all these different things. And so the reason she says sir, which obviously sir, you know, what is sir, what does it mean? It's always a sign of respect. It's a sign of respect. But why does she respect Jesus? Does she really respect Jesus? We really have to look at that. Why is she respecting Jesus? Why is she showing now a difference in her attitude? And it's really because she wants something. He now has something that she wants. He now has kind of a purpose. Before, he's just a Jew. He's somebody different. He's a man. He's a Jew. She doesn't want anything to do with him. But now she finds out that he has something that she would like. He has this living water that he can give to her, that so she won't have to make this task every single day of going to the well. So this would be a good thing. So all of a sudden she starts to respect him because she wants something. And so her respect is kind of conditional. She wants something from him. So first she starts out as, you're a Jew. You're different from me. Not open at all. To, sir, I'm kind of interested now because you can give me something. In other words, I'm going to respect you because you have something to give me. I would say it's pretty similar to a situation in which you wouldn't care to talk to anybody. Maybe there's another person in your class, or another person at your school, or somebody that you're an acquaintance with, and you really don't care too much to talk to them, but you find out they have a new car, and you really want to ride in that car. You maybe want to ride to school, and maybe you don't drive yet. So you find out that they have something that you would like, and so you're kind of like, you kiss up a little bit to them. You want to try to win their favor and get in good with them so that they can give you something, and that's really what she's doing at this point. The next thing that she says is, she says, give me that living water. So she's at this stage. Give me that living water, sir. And he says, well, go get your husband. And she says, I don't have a husband. And he says, he looks her right in the eye and he says, you're right. You don't have a husband. You've had five husbands. And the man you're with now is not your husband. So this woman has been with six men. And we can't be quick to judge her, because in those days, a man could divorce a wife for really no reason. So it may not be that this woman is a bad woman. She may not be a horrible woman. It could be that she has just been hurt many, many times in her life. But the point to think about is, what is it that these six men did not give her? What is it that she didn't find in these six relationships? Because really this story is really about a relationship. And she did not find satisfaction in these six relationships. And now she's talking to Jesus, and she's starting to see this satisfaction. So Jesus says, you're right. You don't have five husbands, and the man you're with now is not your husband. And immediately she says, sir, right? The sign of respect. Sir, I can see that you're a prophet. So the next thing that she says is, I can see that you're a prophet. All right, and a prophet is somebody that speaks the word of God. In the Old Testament, it's always been somebody that was sent by God. And so, sir, I can see that you're a prophet. Why? Why does she go from saying you're different to respecting him because she wants something to now saying, I can see that there's something deeper to you? The reason she calls him a prophet is because she now knows that this man, Jesus, knows about her. That this man Jesus knows and cares about her. So I now know somebody that knows me and cares for me. And this changes everything for her, because now Jesus is not just different. It's not that Jesus can just give her something, kind of like he's a good luck charm or something. But this is a man that knows me. This is a man that knows me personally. This is a personal relationship now. this is actually somebody that, you know, all through the Vatican II documents, and Blessed John Paul II does a great job of this, is, you know, the teaching that Jesus knows us better than we even know ourselves. Jesus knows us better than our best friend. Jesus knows us better than our parents, our mentors. Jesus knows us greater than anybody else, even ourselves. And so, you know, with this, we come to realize that Jesus is the one that reveals to us who we really are. It's Jesus now that is going to tell this woman who she is, what her mission is, what her purpose in life is. It's Jesus that will fulfill this deep thirst that she has. And that's really important. And so she gets to the realization that you are a prophet. You are somebody sent by God. I appreciate you deeply. And then the last thing, which this is just the most beautiful thing, is she calls him Messiah. She calls him Messiah. And this is, you know, this is the one that the Jewish people, and also the Samaritans too, knew this would be the Messiah that would come and save them from their sins. And so why does she call him? And we really have to ask these questions. You know, in teaching this lesson, why does she call him Jew? Why does she call him Sir? Why does she call him Prophet? And now, why does she call him Messiah? And this one's actually pretty clear. If you look in chapter 4, verse 25, the woman said to him, and look at this woman's faith. Once again, we can't assume that this woman is bad, but that she actually could be a very faithful woman. The woman said, I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Anointed. When he comes, he will tell us everything. So look at the faith of this woman. She says, I know that the Messiah will come, the one that's anointed. The one, right? What does it say? You know, not the one that'll save us, but the one that will tell us everything. I know that the Savior will come and he will tell us everything so that there will be no darkness, right? The light comes into the darkness and dispels the darkness. The Word becomes flesh. I know that there will be this person, this Messiah, that will come into our life and he will tell us everything. And what does Jesus say? This is verse 26. Jesus said to her, I am he, the one who is speaking with you. The reason she believes that he is the Messiah is simply because he said so. Jesus said so. Okay, that's why. It's just that simple. What a beautiful faith that this woman at the well has. Jesus says, I am the Messiah. And she believes. There's no hesitation. Very similar to Mary at the Annunciation. You will bear the Son of God. Be it done unto me according to thy word, right? This woman at the well, she believes he's the Messiah simply because he says it. What a beautiful faith. You know, even in regards to going to confession to a priest. Why do we go to confession to a priest? Because Jesus said so. Why do we believe in the Eucharist? Because Jesus said so. And that's the simple, beautiful trust in Jesus, that Jesus says, I am he who am before you now, I am he. And she says yes. And what does she do with this? This is the greatest thing, is the fruit of this faith. Many of the Samaritans of that town, she goes, before I read that, she goes into the, she drops her jar of water, right? She had just got this water, she drops her jug of water, and she goes to the town. She goes right into town, and she says, come see the one that could be the Messiah. He has told me everything about myself. Come see the one who has told me everything. Could he be the Messiah? And she really believes that he is. And then the people, what happens is many of the Samaritans of that town, this is 39, many of the Samaritans of that town began to believe in him because of the word the woman testified. He told me everything that I have done. And actually then Jesus is welcomed by the Samaritans. This is a Jew now being welcomed by the Samaritans. And he stays, it says in Scripture, for 2 days in that community. And I'm sure he taught them. And eventually what happens is these people, that this lady, it goes and she evangelizes. So what is really the fruit of this is it's a progress. It's this conversation that leads to a deep conversion. And if you see right here, if you kind of draw a line here, you know, really what do we see? We see here that this is a very shallow relationship with Jesus. And we really have to ask ourselves, where is our relationship with Jesus? When we read this, we have to say, where is our relationship with Jesus? Do I see Jesus as different? In other words, is Jesus just like, you know, he's way up there. He's God. He wouldn't understand me. He's just different from me. You know, he lived 2,000 years ago, and I just don't kind of get, I don't get this. Or, you know, yeah, I know he's in the Eucharist, but I don't understand that. Is Jesus different? You know, do we consider him as different than us? We have to remember that we are people, and he is a person. God did not remain distant, that God became man. The Word became flesh to dwell among us. You know, and he is not different. But sometimes we have that block, we have that wall. You know, and we know that he's not different because he became a person. He was born of a mother just like we were. He had a father just like we did. He had an occupation just like we do. So we have to remember that, you know, Jesus did become man, that he was a person, and that he did experience all the things that we did. The only thing he didn't experience is sin. That's the only thing he didn't commit sin, but he did experience it. He took on our suffering, right? On the cross, he took on our suffering, and he felt the effect of our sin, just like we feel the effects of sin. So this is really important to understand that. But we have to ask, is our relationship shallow? In other words, you know, do we just see him as different and we don't really care to get to know him? Do we respect him just so that we can get something? Do we pray and say, God, I will go to Mass if you do this? Or God, I will pray the rosary if you do this? Or God, I will start doing good things if you do this? In other words, is there something we believe that he can give us? We know he can give us heaven. We know he can give us maybe peace. But, you know, do we really believe that he would give us something and that's why we're respecting him? Or do we respect him just because he is? You know, and then we take this into a deeper level. You know, this is the deep relationship with Christ. And this is really where we want to take it. We want to see Jesus as sent from God, God's only begotten Son, right? That he is sent from God, from heaven. I am the bread from heaven, right? That is sent by God. And that we come to a realization that we have this personal, deep relationship with him in which we know that he knows us and he cares for us. And then the last one, you know, can we take it all the way to the deepest level, which would be, I know he is the Messiah. I know he is the Messiah because he said that he is the Messiah. I know that he is the Messiah through faith. And am I willing to take this belief right here that he is the Messiah, am I willing to die for that? Am I willing to live for him completely? Just like this woman. This woman goes from saying he's different to being willing to go into the city. And we have to remember, what does that mean to drop her jug and to go into the city? Well, once again, she had 5 husbands and the one she was with now was not her husband. So she probably did not have a good reputation in the city. And also she was at the well at a time when other people weren't at the well, which may have indicated that she wanted to go there when nobody else was there because she didn't want to see anybody. Maybe they gossiped about her. So she drops everything and she goes into a town of people that probably did not like her, and she tells them, she puts herself on the line, and she says she's willing to be humiliated, she's willing to put her life on the line for Jesus. And that's what we really have to say. Are we willing to do that? Are we willing to put our life on the line for Jesus? Are we willing to take that deep relationship? You know me, Jesus. You love me. You care for me. And I believe that. And I want to know you, love you, and care for you. And do we really believe that we would just then say, proclaim to the whole world, even the people that it's difficult to? Could be difficult to proclaim Jesus to our family and to our friends, but we're willing to do that. So it's real important to go through the four things that this woman calls Jesus. But then we also look at why. We have to ask that question, why? And so the next thing, and that's kind of the first point. The second point is, since we've looked at the woman's words, now we want to look at Jesus' words. What's the first words that Jesus says? And so when we look at this, we look at back at 7. A woman of Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, these are his first words, "Give me a drink." Okay, so we just look at this. Give me a drink. Why would Jesus say this? What, you know, he's God. Jesus is God. He doesn't need a drink. Remember, this is the man that could have turned stones to bread. This is the man that multiplied, you know, bread and fish and fed the multitude. This is a man that could calm the storm. He has complete control over nature. He does not need a drink. He does not need a human to give him a drink. So why is it that he says to this woman, give me a drink, when he doesn't need this woman's help? The first reason, there's really two reasons. And the first reason would be this. And you go back to even God and you say, why did God create us? God doesn't need us. He didn't need to create us. He has everything. He's lacking nothing. Why did God create us? He simply created us to share his love. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, the three persons in one God, the Trinity, is a perfect communion of love. And so he created us to love us, to give that love. It would be like if an old man, you know, had tons of money and he never married and he never had children and he had this great inheritance, but he had no one to pass it on to. And that would be the same thing with God. You know, here is God who has everything and he has nobody to pass this on to. And so what happens is he wants to pass this on. And so he creates children, tons of children, children and grandchildren, and he wants to pass this on to us. And so even though God didn't need us, he creates us to share his life with us, to share his love with us. And that's what Jesus is doing. Jesus does not need this woman. Jesus does not need a drink from this woman. But he wants to share his life with her. And so he brings her by asking her something, by depending on her, in a sense, he brings her into his life. And so he wants to share his life. Okay? And he never stops sharing his life. Think about when he's carrying the cross, right? He's carrying his cross and he falls down and then Veronica shows up, right? And Veronica offers him a drink. I think when Veronica offered him a drink, it would probably have reminded him of this beautiful instance in his life when he had that conversation with the woman at the well. So in a way, Veronica is like a new woman at the well. Every time we give a drink of water, just a drink of water to somebody in need, we too are giving to Jesus, and we too are like the woman at the well. So this is just kind of a type in a sense. This is just a symbol of Jesus always asking us for a drink. He says, I am thirsty, which means I want you to share my life with me. I want to share my life with you. And so we can always offer that drink to Jesus, which is really offering ourselves to Jesus. And that's really what comes to the second point, is why does he say, give me a drink? Because he's thirsty. All right? He is thirsty. What is he thirsty for? The Missionaries of Charity, Mother Teresa, Blessed Mother Teresa's group, in every chapel all across the world, they have a phrase in their chapel right next to the crucifix, and it says, I thirst. To remind them that Jesus is thirsty. He's not thirsty for water, he's thirsty for our soul. He's thirsty for our soul. So when he says, give me a drink, what he's saying is, I am thirsty for your soul. He looks at the woman in the well and he says, I am thirsty for your soul. And then he reiterates this on the cross. When he's on the cross, one of the seven last words that he says is, I thirst. To show us that when he was on the cross suffocating from 12 to 3, he was thirsty for our soul. Why did he do this? What motivated him? He was thirsty for us. He was thirsty at the well because he wanted this woman's soul. He wanted to be in communion with her. He didn't want to be different from her. He wanted to be in complete communion with her. And so he was thirsty. He also, you know, it's interesting because Jesus starts off with saying, give me a drink. But it's really not Jesus that's thirsty. Of course, Jesus is thirsty for the soul, as we just talked about. But really, who is really thirsty in this story? Who's the one that really has the thirst? It's the woman. It's us. We're the ones that are thirsty. And so he wants to show us, Jesus once again wants to reveal to us who we are. And so he wants to show us human thirst, that he understands human thirst. You know, as St. Augustine says, we are restless until we rest in you. Our hearts are restless until they rest in God. Our hearts are thirsty until they drink from the fountain that Jesus gives us. And that's really what has to happen. We have to realize that we are thirsty, that we aren't satisfied, that even though we may play a video game, and eventually that video game wears out, even though we may have a great meal, that meal eventually wears out. Everything has a limit in our life. And so we have to realize that Jesus starts the conversation here, and he says these words for that reason. He wants to share his life. There's a few ways you can use the pop culture connection in this lesson. One would be to really talk about the idea of prejudice. And so we see this first word, you are a Jew. And it might be good really to talk about this statement, you are a Jew, you are different. Because really what she is showing is, she's showing a prejudice here. You are a Jew. And what happens if she can't get past this? If she can't get past this block, nothing else will happen. If she can't get past this barrier right here, she will not get to the realization that he's the Messiah. She won't even get to the realization that he's a prophet, and she won't even see that he has anything to give her. And so this is a real important that we get past this barrier and block this barrier down. So what I really consider doing right here is showing the pop culture connection, the PCC. Under the PCC menu, I would really do the Glory Road. The Glory Road video, and then Remember the Titans. Okay? Because in those two videos, we have a college basketball team in the mid-60s, and then we have a high school football team in which there was, you know, they brought the black players and the white players together, and they had to deal with it. Like, they did not want to, they saw each other as different, and they didn't respect each other's talents. And so what happens in both these cases of the high school football team and Remember the Titans, and also the college basketball team in Glory Road, is that you see that if this team does not get past their differences, they will definitely not be able to win. They definitely will not be able to play together. But in both of these instances, it's very similar to the woman at the well, because they get past their differences and then they win. And it takes courage to do that. We have to make that step. And we talk a lot about racial prejudice and economic prejudice and different things like that. But what we have to understand is, do we put a barrier between us and Christ? Do we see Christ as so different, God is so different than us, so other than us, that we're not willing to take it to the next level and succeed? So I definitely recommend that. Another thing that you may want to kind of start off is go back to that question, give me a drink, and talk about the sense of human thirst. And with this, there's also two PCCs that you can use, the pop culture connection. You can use the Sprite commercial. And the Sprite commercial is pretty cool because it has, you know, everybody's playing basketball. It's a hot day. They drink a thing of Sprite, and then they jump in the court, which turns into a swimming pool. And it says at the very end, which you might want to pause it says, freedom from thirst. And you might think about that a little bit and say, what does that mean, freedom from thirst? And as humans, will we ever have a freedom from thirst? As humans, will we ever be free from our desires and our thirst? No, we won't. And thank God we have this thirst. Because if our thirst could be satisfied by material things, there would be no need for God. But we know that these material things, even these other relationships, just like the woman at the well, six relationships did not satisfy her human thirst. And so with this Sprite commercial, you can kind of talk about that. What would we be like if we were free from thirst? And we're not free from thirst, so we continue to strive for Christ. We continue to search for that living water. The other one is the adoration clip. And this one is just really kind of good because it talks about different longings, you know. Maybe addictions to internet pornography. It might be addictions to, you know, whatever. Or this love for sports, in which we care so much about sports, but we realize there has to be something more. Or we get frustrated in school and we want to give up. And so this commercial really kind of, the adoration PCC, it really is an invitation from Christ to share his life with him. And just maybe just to close with a third point, and this would be the fact that we have to have unity and diversity. We have to have unity and diversity in things. And the best example I'd really like to give is, you know, with this, when we're talking about prejudice, this could be a continuation of that. We have to have unity in things, and we have to have diversity. I think the best example would be a football play. You know, what is a play, what is an offense, what are they united in doing? Where is their unity? It's in the play. In other words, we're going to run this play, you know, blue 42, blue 42, we're going to run blue 42. But if the running back thinks that they're doing blue 42, and the linemen think that they're doing another play, there's going to be disaster, you know, because the running back is going to run towards a hole. that the linemen are not going to open for them because they're playing, doing two different plays. So what has to happen in life is we have to be on the same page. There has to be a unity in what we're doing. We have to be running the same play. But we also understand, even though we're all running the same play and we're united in running that play, we also have to understand that each person has a part. Each person has a role. The lineman has to do something. The center has to do something. The quarterback has to do something, and the running back has to do something. And so everything in life has this unity and this diversity kind of playing a part. And we see that, we have to see both of these, or we're not going to be able to progress past our prejudices. And we even see this in the church, that we're united, right? What are we united in? We're united in our doctrine, we're united in our morals, and we're united in our liturgy. But yet, we're very unique people. We have different preferences in a sense, we have different ways we think, we have different things, ways we act, but we're united in the church, in the Catholic Church. And that's a church of unity and diversity. So I just want to finish with a prayer. There is a beautiful prayer that I recommend using. It's the prayer by St. Thomas Aquinas. It's called the Prayer for Students. And in that prayer, it talks about asking God to point out the beginning, direct the progress, and help in the completion. So we can just kind of end with that prayer and think about that prayer. Really when we say that, point out the beginning. Jesus is pointing out the beginning to this woman. This woman at the well is very confused. She's had a hurt life. And he points out the beginning, and he says, the beginning is now. And he directs the progress. He directs the progress of the conversation from saying Jew to sir to prophet to Messiah. He directs the progress of that conversation with his love and with his compassion. And then he completes it. And actually, her cooperation also completes it, in which she goes out and she's a changed person. And she evangelizes to her community. So we just want to say that short little three lines of that prayer, but you can use the whole thing in the presentation mode. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear God, please point out the beginning, direct the progress, and help in the completion. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.